हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर गरिमा जैन, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ इंग्लिश इन एमएसटी कॉलेज भरतपुर, एंड दिस इज़ एन ई लेक्चर रिकॉर्डेड फॉर द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ बीए पार्ट सेकंड, सब्जेक्ट इंग्लिश लिटरेचर पेपर फर्स्ट. सो गाइस, दिस इज़ एन ई लेक्चर ऑन द वेरी फर्स्ट पोएम इन आवर सिलेबस. द फर्स्ट पेपर इज़ ऑफ पोएट्री एंड ड्रामा एंड वी आर बिगिनिंग विद पोएट्री. द फर्स्ट पोएम दैट वी हैव इन आवर सिलेबस इज़ बाय James Thomson, Hymn on Solitude is the title of the poem. I want to apologize here for the for a mistake here in this presentation. There's a mistake in the spelling of Thomson. Extra A is added somewhere at many places. So you may correct it. This is Thomson is the correct spelling. So let's begin. Let's have a little introduction about James Thomson first. James Thomson, he is one of the most prominent poets of transitional age. His life span is from 1700 to 1748. That is, he was born in 1700, in the year 1700, and he died in 1748. He is known as the transitional poet. Transition, the word transition means a kind of movement from the old to the new. And transitional age, it stands as a threshold between neoclassicism and romanticism. Neoclassicism, here neo means new classicism. You all have gone through many poets of neoclassical age in your BA Part 1st syllabus. So in neoclassical poetry, we saw that the writers wrote typically, especially about town poetry. They wrote about coffee houses, club houses. They wrote about the noble strata of society, the aristocratic class. Their poetry was artificial because they used high-defined language, high-pitched language. They reveled not in the beauties of nature, but in the fashions of fashionable views, thus the trends of the going on trends of the fashionable views and damsels, like in Rape of the Lock. That was in your syllabus. No, that was not in your syllabus. That is in MA previous. Okay. While in romanticism, in romantic poetry, we'll see that the writers, they enjoy, they celebrate, they revel in the beauties of nature. The language is simple, not artificial. And transition, it stands between the two. It stands between the neoclassicism and the romanticism. And we see that in this transitional age, the writers show a slow movement from the classical trends to the romantic trends. So we see that there are some features of the classical age, some characteristics of the classical age, as well as some features and characteristics of the romantic age in the poetry of the transitional period. In the poetry of James Thomson, we will find an inclination towards nature and rural life. And while he talks about nature and rural life, we'll see that later he'll also inspire other poets to talk of the beauty of nature. James Thomson, he was a contemporary of Alexander Pope, but we see a visible difference between the two. Alexander Pope was the one who is the chief of the neoclassical poetry, who took neoclassical poetry to its highest standards. But Thomson was not interested in any way in the subjects like which were used by neoclassical poets. He was interested more in the beauties of nature, more in the beauties of natural objects. Not just subject, in form and style too, we'll see that Thomson discarded heroic couplet. Heroic couplet was the main type of writing which was used by neoclassical poets. But we'll see that Thomson, he discarded heroic couplet and he experimented with other forms of poetry like lyric, like blank verse and Spenserian stanza. Some of his most popular poems are Seasons, Liberty, Castle of Indolence, etc. Let's come to the poem. This poem, Hymn on Solitude, it was possibly written in 1725. Possibly written because we don't know the exact date of writing. There is a controversy, but it was possibly written in 1725. There are many editions of this poem. The first publication of this poem was in 1729 and it was by James Ralph. It has gone through many alterations, that is many editions were made in this poem. And the poem that we'll read today in this lecture, it is taken from a collection of poems by several hands, which was published by Robert Dodsley in 1748. We'll see in this poem a clear departure from neoclassical trends, from the characteristic features of the neoclassical poetry. As the title suggests, the poem is about solitude. Hymn is a kind of a prayer, and the poet is here celebrating solitude. Solitude is loneliness. We all know solitude means when the person is lonely, when the atmosphere is lonely, and solitude is generally associated with a kind of gloom, with a kind of melancholy. But here in this poem we'll see that the poet celebrates melancholy. For the poet, solitude actually is not an absence of company. This is very interesting, that solitude is not an absence of company, but it is present with a spirit of solitude. In solitude, there is a spirit of solitude which is actually found, which is actually present in every aspect of nature. So the poet is talking about nature here, and he is saying that every aspect of nature, every object of nature, hills, valleys, rivers, every aspect of nature is dominated by the spirit of solitude. Very interesting poem. Let's begin it. So the poet begins with welcoming solitude. He says, "Hail ever pleasing solitude." Hail is welcome. Ever pleasing solitude. Solitude is ever pleasing for the poet. Solitude is not something to be unhappy of. Solitude is not something which is associated with gloom or sadness for the poet. Solitude is something which makes the poet always happy. He says, "Companion of the wise and good." Solitude is something which is a companion, which is a friend. Of whom? Of the wise and the good. Wise people find happiness in it, and good people, good-natured people, good-hearted people revel in solitude. They celebrate solitude. Then the poet says, "But from whose holy piercing eye the herd of fools and villains fly." So here the poet is making a clear-cut demarcation that who all actually enjoy solitude and who all do not like it. So it is liked by the wise people, by the intelligent people and the good-hearted ones. But there are some who abstain from it, who fly from it, who don't like it. And who are these? The herd of fools and villains. Foolish people, herd, the group of herd actually is the word which is used for a group of cattle. Here the word is used for a group of, for the company of fools, the foolish people and villains. Villains, those who are bad hearted people, those who are not good natured, those who are not happy people, they fly from it, they don't like it. Whose holy piercing eye? Yeah, here holy piercing eye, this phrase is used for solitude, that from the sight from the sight of solitude, these people fly, these people refrain, these people abstain. They don't want to be in the company of solitude. Who? The foolish and the villains. Oh, how I love with thee to walk and listen to thy whispered talk. Now, after making a demarcation between two kinds of people who like solitude and who don't like it, the poet says about himself that I love with thee to walk. I love with thee to walk, that I enjoy your company. I love solitude. When I walk, I love solitude. That I want to be in the company of, I like to be in the company of solitude. Listen to thy whispered talk. This is important. Solitude, in the whole poem, we will see that solitude is actually given, it is abstracted with some abstract qualities. It is associated with some abstract qualities. We call it, call this revised personification. Solitude is actually an abstract quality, right? We cannot see it, we cannot touch it. It is an abstract quality. It is not concrete. And when the poet will say that solitude can speak to him, solitude can listen to him, this means that the poet is associating some human qualities, some personal qualities, the qualities of a person to it. This device is called, in literary devices, the device of personification. Manvikaran, jise hum Hindi mein kehte hain. Okay? So the poet is using this device to its full, and he is saying that I can listen to thy whispered talk. I can listen you talking to me, and you talk to me in whispers, in low voice. Whispers in low voice, in low subdued voice, not loud voice. Your voice is low. Which innocence and truth imparts and melts the most obdurate hearts. One very important quality of solitude is that it imparts innocence and truth to the person. It imparts, it gives innocence and truth. It shows him truth. It leads him to go on the right way. And it also gives him innocence. This is the quality that, these are the qualities that solitude gives to the person who enjoy it or who lives with solitude. And it has the quality, solitude also has the quality to melt the most obdurate heart. To melt, it can melt the most obdurate heart. Obdurate is the most adamant heart, most tough ones. The tough ones who are not dismissed, who are not shaken by anything. The most tough people, they can also be melted by solitude. Solitude has this much power. So solitude is a very powerful thing. Solitude is a very powerful aspect. Let's see it again. Hail ever-pleasing solitude, companion of the wise and good, but from whose holy piercing eye the herd of fools and villains fly. Oh, how I love with thee to walk and listen to thy whispered talk, which innocence and truth imparts and melts the most obdurate hearts. Then the poet says, a thousand shapes you wear with ease, and still in every shape you please. You wear a thousand different shapes. Means you take different kind of shapes. You show yourself in many different ways, in various ways. Still in every shape you please, and you are pleasing. Every form of yours, every shape of yours is equally pleasing, is equally joyful. This is how solitude is presented, how solitude, how we can we can enjoy solitude, how we can need solitude. He says that solitude is not present in any one form, it is present in many thousand forms. That is, solitude is present in many thousand ways of nature, many thousand objects of nature. As he says, now wrapped in some mysterious dream, a lone philosopher you seem. Now the poet is using many kinds of similes and metaphors for solitude. He is comparing solitude with a lone philosopher. First he says that you seem like a lone philosopher. A lone philosopher? A lonely philosopher who enjoys himself and who enjoys the company of solitude. You can be enjoyed in his company. Now wrapped in some mysterious dream. Who is wrapped? Who is engaged in some mysterious dream? No one knows where the lonely philosopher is lost. He is lost in his own thoughts. Solitude can be enjoyed. Solitude can be seen in a lone philosopher, in the form of a lone philosopher. Okay, so solitude, the abstract quality, is here taking a concrete attire, is taking, wearing a concrete garment here, that of a lone philosopher. Solitude is presenting itself as a lone philosopher who is wrapped, who is engaged, who is lost in some mysterious dream. Then, now quick from hill to vale you fly, and now you sweep the vaulted sky. So first the poet compared solitude with a lone philosopher, with a human being. Now the poet is comparing solitude to different objects of nature, to different beauties of nature. He says, now quick from hill to vale you fly. You fly quickly from hill to vale, from one hill to another valley. That is, in hills and valleys you make your presence, you are present there. And now you sweep the vaulted sky. The vaulted sky? The sky when the clouds are hung low. That the sky is making a vault kind shape. Vault is a kind of dome, and the sky is full of clouds. We can have this picture before us, that the cloud is full of clouds and the clouds are hung low and it is taking the shape of a vault. So the vaulted sky, you sweep it, you pervade the vaulted sky. When there are clouds, beautiful clouds in the sky, and it is looking like a vault, it appears that you are pervading there. You are present there. And nature triumphs in your eye. And this is the triumph of nature when you are there. In the beauties of nature when you are there, this is victory of nature. Nature smiles through you. Nature, you are present in nature. For it says that solitude is not something that is not present. And anywhere, it is present everywhere. In nature it is present everywhere. The simplest meaning is that solitude is present in every aspect of nature. In hills it is present, in valleys it is present, and in clouds and sky, when you look at the sky, you can enjoy solitude. The spirit of solitude is present in natural beauties. Then straight again you court the shade, and pining hang the pensive head. Then straight again, you court the shade. The shade, the evening shade, you court the shade, that is, you make a courtship, you woo, you make love with the shade, you make love with the dark, that is, in the evening time, in the darkness of the evening also, you are present. And pining hang the pensive head. And sometimes we also see, because evening is actually the time, in through the word shade, the poet is here referring to the time of the darkness, that is evening. And evening, dusk time especially, is associated with gloom, pensiveness. pensive is sadness. So sometimes solitude can also be seen as a person with pensive thoughts, with gloomy thoughts. Okay, so these are the different ways in which solitude is making its presence. These are the different forms through which we can enjoy solitude. So this is it for today's lecture. In the next lecture, we'll read the rest of the poem. Thank you, friends. Hope you had a good time. Bye.